Okay, so in this next part, we are going to add a button. To do that, we will use the JButton class from the Swing package. So back here in my test frame class, I will import javax.swing.jbutton in order to be able to use the JButton class. And back here in my fields, I am going to add another one to serve as a reference to the JButton that I will create. I'll type private and then JButton because that is the data type. And then I'll just name this field button. And then here in the constructor, I will instantiate it. I will say button is equal to new JButton. And then in the parentheses, I can also pass a string argument that will serve as the button text. You're not required to do this, but most of the time I do want my buttons to have a label. So here I'll just say click me. Now the next thing I have to do is add it to the container. Creating the button doesn't mean that it gets added immediately. I'm going to have to add it to the container using the add method. The add method is also something that we inherit by extending the JFrame class. I'm going to do that here inside our setup GUI method. I have to make sure that I do that before I call setVisible, otherwise we won't see it. So here I will just say add, and inside the parentheses I will pass a reference to the component that I want to add, which in this case is button. So now when I test this program, the window now has a button. Up next, we are going to make our program print out a message whenever the user clicks on this button. Right now, nothing happens when you click on it, so let's close this window and go back to our code. Okay, so at this point, I just want to give you a heads up that this upcoming code for our button is going to be a little long, especially considering that all we want to do here is make the button print a line whenever we click on it. So let's get started. To do what we want to do, we are going to need to create an event handler. An event handler is some code that allows us to tell our program to respond in some way whenever some specific event happens. An event handler is made up of four general things: an event source, an event listener, and a response. Let's talk about what those are, starting with the event. An event is something that happens while the program is running. Some examples are when the user types something or when a window opens. For this example, the event that we want to watch out for is when the user clicks on the button. And next, we have the event source. The event source is the object that dispatches the event. In most cases, this is the object that the event happens to. So for example, if the user clicks on a button, then the event source is the button that was clicked on. And then we have the event listener. An event listener is an object, the job of which is to wait and listen for the event to occur. So if we want to handle a click event, then we will have to create an object that will listen out for whenever a user clicks on something. You can think of a listener object as a lookout person. This person just sits there and waits and just listens to the environment, waiting for the event to happen. And finally, whenever a listener object hears the event occur, it will then trigger the desired response. The response is what we would like to happen when the event occurs. For example, if a user clicks on a button, then a response could be to play a sound file, or to display an image, or maybe to open a new window. In this example, we'll just create a basic response that will have the program print out a message when the button is clicked. Okay, so now that I've introduced you to the concept of event handlers, how do we implement it in Java? Right now, we already have our event source, which would be our button. So how do we specify the event that we want to listen for? Within the context of Java, a click on a button can be referred to as an action. So from this point onward, when I say the word action, I will be using it to mean click. So how do we make our program respond to an action on a button? In other words, how do we make it respond to a click? To do that, we need to create a listener object. But we can't just create any object. An object that listens for an action must implement an interface known as the Action Listener Interface. And to be able to create that object, we'll first need to import two things: the Action Listener Interface and the Action Event class. Instead of being a part of Swing, these two are part of the Java AWT package. So let's go back up here where our import statements are, and let's type import java.awt.event.actionListener and import java.awt.event.actionEvent. In this video, we won't actually be making use of the ActionEvent class, but we are still going to need to import it, otherwise we'll get an error. So now we've imported all the things we need to implement our event handler code, we can go ahead and proceed. As I mentioned earlier, ActionListener is an interface. So we must create a class that implements this interface and overrides the methods required by it. So let's go ahead and do that. But instead of defining that class in a different file, let's define it inside our TestFrame class, making it an inner class. Sometimes it makes sense to make a class an inner class so that we do not have to create another Java file for it. In some ways, this helps make our code easier to maintain. To declare an inner class, you can optionally specify an access modifier. I'll just make this one private, since I don't plan on using it outside of my TestFrame class. And then it's followed by the word class, followed by the class name. Let's just name this one MyActionListener. And then to implement the ActionListener interface, we type implementsActionListener. So now we've defined our inner class. But as you can see, we are getting an error here. This is because we are implementing the ActionListener interface, but we have not yet defined the actual method that the interface requires us to define. So let's do that. For the ActionListener interface, it only has one abstract method that we need to define. Its signature is public void action performed, and it has one parameter that accepts an action event object. Let's call it AE. We won't be making use of this action event for now, but just know that you must declare that parameter as well because the ActionListener interface requires it. And then we put the opening and closing curly brace to mark the body of the method. So now the error disappears. We do have a warning here though. You can ignore warnings. This one is just suggesting that we put an override annotation before we start the method. You would put this if you are overriding a superclass method or if you are implementing an interface method. It's only optional, but it can help prevent some problems. Okay, so what is this method going to be used for? Recall that our listener object's job is to sit there and wait for an action to be performed on the button. When the listener object detects that, it will then call this action performed method, and it will execute the code defined inside its body. In other words, this method is where we define the response that we want our program to make whenever our button is clicked. If, for example, we wanted to display a picture when the button is clicked, then we would put the code for displaying a picture inside this method body. But for now, let's just do something simple and print out a message. Let's just say system.out.println, the button has been clicked. So when our button gets clicked, our program will display this message in the output window. Note that we do not need to explicitly call this function anywhere in our code. We don't have to type something like object.actionPerformed and pass to it some action event object. Instead, this method will automatically get invoked every time the button is clicked. Everything else that makes that work is encapsulated away or hidden from us. We don't need to know those details. We just need to make sure we write our event handler code properly, and Java will do the rest. Okay, so now let's make an action listener object. I'll go back up here and create a field, private my action listener, because that is the name of our class and therefore its data type. And then I'll just name this field MAL, short for my action listener. And then here in the constructor, I'll say MAL is equal to new my action listener in order to create the actual listener object. Okay, so now we have our event source, which is the button. We've also got our listener object. Right now, you can think of them as two strangers. They don't know each other yet. The listener object, at this point, is not yet going to care about whether or not the button gets clicked. To introduce them to each other, we need to use the addActionListener method. So let's go here, after we add the button to the container. To use this method, we specify the event source, which is our button, followed by .addActionListener. And then we pass to it a reference to the listener object, which in this case is MAL. So now we've effectively registered our listener object so that it knows to wait and listen for an action to be performed on this button. When that happens, the action performed method gets invoked and our message gets printed out. So now let's test our program. And when we click on this button, our message gets printed out.